The lads have told me that they can't leave until you finish eating.
That's right. Is that that's right. That's a rule.
You know, they start banging the salt cellars.
Well, they try to, and but the more they bang, the longer it doesn't work. Just help yourself, all right? Well,
I don't think too many people know me that well. I've got masses of colleagues, but I haven't got a real pal. The only real pal that I ever had was a fellow called Tom Wilson, who, when I went to Fulham at 17 years of age, we shared a room together for about 5 years.
Yes, well, there's the mischievous group alongside Janet Scott. I mean, Bobby there looking as if butter wouldn't melt in his mouth. Alongside him, his great mate Tom Wilson. They shared a room together. And on this side, of course, Jimmy Hill, Johnny Haynes, and Bedford Jezzard, who later became the manager.
Well, ask him, he says we had our day off Saturday.
All you do in football is get bloody changed. You get up in the morning, you put your clothes on, you come to the ground, you take them off.
Bobby went under Don Howe to West Bromwich Albion, scored many goals, played in the England team, very popular player. But it was the coaching element that Don Howe managed to persuade and bring into his life.
Would you sign those lads?
It's like this in my day.
You know, I was born and bred here, and my wife was born and bred here, went to school here, played my early football here. And do you know, when I left in 1950, that's 50, more than 50 years ago, well, I came back here. In 1999, so I was away almost 50 years.
Why didn't you go to play for Newcastle? Did they not want you?
Yeah. Yeah, they did. I was on amateur form, schoolboy amateur forms from Middlesbrough. Then when I was 17 and old enough to sign pro, Newcastle came after me. And for some reason, I chose Fulham.
Newcastle was your team, wasn't it?
No. My father was black and white. He bled black and white, my father.
So what did he say?
He couldn't understand me. Yeah. I think I disappointed him.
They're all starting to look over at you now, because I think they're all finished.
Well, it goes silent. And as you say,
they start banging
the table with the salt cellars. But they're not much more different to what you and I were when we were kids. You know? They have more money, they have bigger cars and better cars. Have you seen the cars out there?
Nice cars.
No, they don't know what a mortgage is, you know. Yeah. I had a mortgage. Do you have a mortgage? I had a mortgage.
Well,
they don't have mortgages.
I don't need mortgages. Nice cars. Tell you what, one thing's not changed. They all want to go home.
Yeah, I'm going to do that. Let them go. Okay, yes, nothing to say. You can go. The squad is up. You've got the squad. There's a section of you trained this afternoon that's the younger variety. That's fine. Those in the squad, take care. You know what it means. Look after yourself. And we'll see you tomorrow. Okay, good luck.
When he came to Newcastle, you could see that's a Bobby Robson team. I mean, the enthusiasm, the fighting spirit, the commitment, and you know, players having fun playing football. They enjoy it.
Right, just let me just go through the logistics first, eh? We more or less know their team, and we spent 2 days on this, haven't we? How they play, how to counteract it, what can we do, what do they do? Can we handle the two strikers, Anelka and Gota? Gota's strong, not bad in the air. Anelka obviously has the pace. Does the ball need to be moved? It's a free kick. If you turn your back, they're at you. It only needs one player to cop out, and we're short. The chain is weakened. Defend as a team, and we've talked about Alan and Craig doing the windscreen wiper job. What about us? Our belief, our command of the ball, our pacey players, so it's Dyer, it's Bellas, it's Laurent, Nobby's quick, JJ's got the legs. Hey, and listen, we have a fantastic home record. We know the position. It's a big opportunity for us, our first visit back home since Wolverhampton. Give something back. And let's threaten Arsenal and Manchester United. Let's challenge them. We're fourth. So we a skip away. Can you turn on JJ and can you play four? Come on, I want to win. Go and get it for me. Okay. Should we get going then?
Yeah, can
I do that? Uh-huh. Evening Chronicle.
You're not upsetting anyone.
Who's that now?
Nobody has that sort of money.
Some
clubs haven't got a coin. Not a coin. Yeah. Right, let's go.
So who are you buying for 15 million? Who are they?
Woodgate and Claverson.
There you go, you see. Job's been done for you.
In the summer, I have my own little patio where I can have my cup of coffee.
You can move in here.
Yeah, yeah. We're going to make this a putting green.
That'll get me going, isn't it?
We're going to make this a putting green.
Yeah.
And to be fair, the chairman's done very nice. If you put the names up and the badges, you see all the little badges on the top there, on the apexes? The conversion of this has cost quite a bit.
Well, the academy, you've got to start producing your own now.
Well, we have, yeah. That's what we did. I mean, when I was manager at Ipswich Town Football Club, I used to come with in steel players. Didn't I? I mean, I did, didn't I? You know, we had a few Geordies. I even had Gaz going down at 14. Did you not know?
No.
I had Gaz going at Ipswich when he was 14 years of age.
Did you?
He was about that wide,
yeah.
About that high. I'm all I said, who sent him down? Like, you know, but he was clever.
Yeah. But you never took him?
Never took him. He always had a black and white eye, actually. I think he went down for a little look, you know. He quite liked it, but we had a very active scouting policy.
You picked him eventually.
I did. He just sneaked in, didn't he? Good times, Gary.
Yeah,
they were good times. That far away from it, from the...
Still think about that?
Never forget it. Wouldn't say every day, but many times in a year, when every time we come to a big match.
Yeah.
You know, I'll never forget it. We'll whisk it away, son.
Yeah.
A whisk it away.
It's the only thing, I think, from my whole career that I think, if only you could change that little bit, because you're so close to winning a World Cup.
I just felt if we'd got through, we would have actually beaten Argentina because
they weren't great, were they?
Yeah. Good side in the end, Gary. Will we?
Mm.
I mean, a good side.
We
difficult
were
to
really
beat.
Good side.
Oh yeah.
Chipped in and volleyed in, and it's there by David Platt. England have done it in the last minute of extra time.
And we did it without Brian Robson. Yeah, we sent him home again, didn't we? Yeah. Like 86, sent him home in 86, sent him home in 1990.
It's always a big loss.
Oh. Unfortunate.
Yeah, you changed tactics through that World Cup, didn't you, to cope with Holland, and then sort of kept it for one or two matches.
Yeah, I kept
it
for one or two.
I mean, there's always been this supposed rumour that was forced on you by the players, which I've vehemently denied for you on occasions.
Yeah.
But the truth is, you did take players' advice, but at the same time, you ultimately made the decision yourself.
But we took players who, if we needed to change the system, we had the personnel.
Yeah.
Should have won it. And every one of their penalties.
Right in the corner.
Right in the corner, everyone.
How did you?
After the overtime, we stayed next to each other, you know, we shaked hands, and then we said, Bobby, and he was very, very fair and very nice and very, I was very nervous, you know, Bobby, he was a very, very experienced coach, a world-class coach. I was more or less a newcomer, you know, with two World Cup participation. And he said, Franz, we did a very, very good job. We saw a very, very good game. Now it's not up to us, you know, whoever will be the winner. Now it's up to them. He was so quiet and so relaxed. I felt very, very, very sorry because, you know, I don't know so many coaches and so many managers, you know, they come in this period of a game to you and speak in a way like this. So this moment I will never forget.
England are out of the World Cup on penalty kicks.
Well, if they do, I'll have a good press conference this afternoon.
Okay.
Don't say anything. Don't make it a statement. Leave it to me. All right, let's go the other way. Get back in there. How are you, sir? All right?
Ready?
No, I'm never ready.
There we go. Happy to wait.
I can see it.
15 minutes.
I won't talk to you while you're on the bike.
Well, you can talk to me now because I've started, but don't talk
to me. For the first minute.
Don't talk to me halfway through. But you see this lad here? This is the other side of the game, Gary.
Yeah.
This kid here, young hog, had a double fracture.
Really?
Massive injury. He was as tough as teak.
And how you doing?
I hate it.
I'll leave you to carry on for 10 minutes. I'll go and find a loo and I'll come back. I don't like to see a man suffer.
I'm going on those machines later on.
I'll talk to you when you're on there.
All right.
I spent a really good time with the mister. I learned a lot with him because I was young and he was talking a lot with me. And I said to you that experience would make me much more strong.
Tan solo 20 años jugar en un equipo como Barcelona no es fácil. Y bueno, luego triunfar, marcar muchos goles. Se queda aún más difícil para tener la tranquilidad de mantener este nivel. Así que Bobby Robson me ayudó mucho a mantener y me enseñó mucho para mi carrera.
Bobby Robson, 64 years old, but younger than springtime.
It teach me to see the life is not just good things, no? Sometimes you pass bad moments and you learn with that, no? For improve and to get more strong.
You're not the archetypal 70-year-old, you know.
Well, a lot of the younger managers actually play with the players, don't they? Like when they play the NBA,
the
they join in, don't they? But I don't do that, you know. Because I'm not good enough for them anymore, you know what I mean? I'm not.
Well, you're not supposed to be.
Not by a long way. When I went abroad, I didn't want to make a fool of myself, so I just became a coach.
You nearly said I was working with better players then, didn't you?
Well, no, I worked with some very good players.
You were?
Oh, I did. Figo, Ronaldo, Guardiola.
Romario,
yeah. Terrific player.
He was easy to deal with, wasn't he, Romario?
No, he wasn't. But he was a great player.
Do you think in your new days you'd have said, you're out?
I might have done.
Yeah.
I might have done. But I learned how to handle players individually. I learned about man management. I forgot the exercise there. One. I think we were number 15.
You're in!
His man management for me is second to none. Whether he's dealing with a 16 or 17-year-old kid or whether he's got a superstar, he can handle them and he knows how to get the best out of them.
That quality of seeing every player, how if he's happy, if he's a bit unhappy because he's not playing or whatever is going on, he sees everything.
If he's had a go at you, which he does on numerous occasions, he's very clever at picking you back up, putting your arm around you, telling you that you're one of his blue chip boys or he can get this out of you, and he's very, very clever at that.
Sometimes you've got to forsake your own match for the benefit of the team.
What he said to me, like, you know, you can reach, you can go there all the way to be one of the best strikers, that changed my mind. And that's, I think, when I turned into the professional.
You've had a few things over your career where you've had to, you know, sort out dressing room difficulties. When you first started, wasn't it particularly, it was difficult at Fulham and then Ipswich, you had your problems early on?
I lost my job at Fulham, and I wondered why.
How hard was that difficult to take? I know things have been great since, but that must have been...
Gary, I tell you, I was told to report to the board, and they told me that they were dispensed with my services. And I remember the same day, after coming out of the board meeting, I walked onto the middle of Craven Cottage. I stood in the centre circle, it was absolutely deserted. I shed tears.
Really?
I did. I lost my job. I was sacked. I was going to go home.
Were you worried at that stage that was it for you with football?
Well, yeah.
Did you think you'd get back in? Or what were you going to do?
I was a young manager. I had no reputation. I had no credibility. I had no CV. Mm. I lost my first job in 8 months, so who's going to employ me?
Mm.
I went on the door. I didn't like it. I had to go on the door. I had no money. Because I remember 6 months later, I got a job at Ipswich on £6,000 a year.
Nobody. What got you the job, do you think? Your passion? Was it there then?
I don't know. Hopefully, the fact that a lot of people had turned it down anyway, so they were up the gum tree.
Get your heads down. Play for the first goal. The first goal comes your way. We're in club.
I wasn't much older than a couple of the old pros. And I'd had a brush with a couple of these lads in training, on the training ground anyway.
Who were they?
And a boy called Tommy Carroll and Billy Baxter.
Mm.
They were good players,
mm,
but they were tough hombres. And on this particular day, I put the team sheet up without them, left them out of the team, and they just, smashed it in my face, rubbed it in my face. Like, that's what we think of, you know. And there was a scuffle, and there was a scuffle. And before we know where we are,
We are actually having a punch-up.
Really? Did you win that one as well?
I won that one as well. It wasn't very pleasant, Gary, and I'm not proud of it. But I stood my ground. And I think, when I look back, when I stood on that ground at Craven Cottage when I lost the sack, I vowed, I said, I'll never be in this position again. I'll never get sacked again. So when I met a problem, I dealt with it.
There's been a few times in his career here at Newcastle where he's pulled me into his office and sat me down and said, well, you're not doing this right, you're not doing that right, I want you to get back to this, I'll leave you out if you're not going to do this properly, I want you to do it my way, which I think is great, because if he can do it to big name players, then as I said, he can do it to anyone.
There was a board, you know, he had a marker, and he drew Mickey Mouse on the board. Then he said to the player, you look like him yesterday in the tackle. And all the dressing, you know, all the players were laughing, and you know, and for that player it was, oh my God, it was embarrassing, of course, you know, comparison with Mickey Mouse. I mean, it can be hard. I mean, it's just sense of humor as well, but it's the message behind it.
I think he reads you a little bit. I think he knows what you're going to try and do.
But he's very polite. He wants things done the right way. Tuck your shirt in, put your socks up. Wouldn't stand some of the haircuts today. Other clubs, he doesn't like jewelry. Doesn't like this. Doesn't like that.
Kieran Dyer shouted, "Boss, stop the bus." He says, "What for?" He says, "I've left my earring in the dressing room." And that is the only time I've seen him actually lost for words. And he turned to me and he says, "You see, that's what I've got to put up with. He's left his earring in the dressing room."
Bobby thought, well, in my day, first of all, we wouldn't have an earring worth that much. And secondly, if we did, we wouldn't tell the manager that that we'd left it in the dressing room.
Does that irritate you when they drive in the car park, some of those flash motors?
I've got used to it now. It did irritate me in the beginning. Yeah, times have changed, Gary. For the better. I mean, I don't begrudge them it, not at all. All I wanted to do is to appreciate it.
Have you always been careful with your money, Bobby?
Always.
Yeah?
Oh,
you're not tight, are you?
No. I go into a group, I'm first to pay, I think. But I know the value of it. My father, you know, was a miner and had five kids, and I've always tried to spend the club's money like it was my own. Even though I'm saying to President Nunes, you've got to buy Ronaldo. And it went from 10 million to 12 million and 13 million and $15 million. And he said to me, this is a lot of money, but in Spanish, mucho dinero, Bobby. Mucho dinero, mucho dinero, Bobby, you know? Baga, you know, pay.
Es muy bueno.
And in the end, we paid $20 million. You've got to be your own man, and if you're not, and you fail, then you've only got yourself to blame, because you've taken somebody else's advice, not your own. And you can't do that. You've got to have really good, you know, strong willpower.
Did you ever succumb to media influence?
No.
Never?
I don't honestly think I ever did. No.
Was there ever a time where they nearly drove you out of the England job?
I think my worst time was after the European Championships, in which you
88.
Played with me, 88. You know, when we played three games and lost three and played pretty dismally, really. 2 weeks after that European Championship, you went down with hepatitis,
well,
didn't you?
Yeah, because if you remember, we had a little fallout. You remember, the last game against Russia, I had no energy, and
I
was awful in that match.
Who would have thought that the end of this championship would come early for Gary Lineker?
And in the end, it came out that I had hepatitis. You remember that?
I do remember it.
They weren't just awful, they were embarrassing.
Bobby Robson's side have a little over a quarter of an hour to repair the damage.
He was a wreck. I thought this was a heart attack waiting to happen. So I wrote a piece which said, you got to go. For your own health, you got to go. And the following week, Don Howe had the heart attack. He's number two. And Bobby's still going strong now.
Tell you what, you're much better leaving after 90 than you would have been 88.
Well, that's right.
Yeah.
So you got a personal number plate then, Bobby?
Yes.
Very nice.
I bought that when I was in Barcelona. I was looking through the Daily Express one day with all the numbers, and I couldn't believe it. RWR, Robert William Robson, won, because that's the money won. And I rang the guy up, and
you got it off him.
Yeah, I did.
Had to pay for it, mind you. Have you been on this little restaurant on floor two, have you?
No.
Been there?
I don't think this is a football club. Look at this. You see like the skirting boards and the doors and the architrave. You see every door on every floor. Look at this as a door. It's just fantastic. Every door in this place has got that architrave and that solid oak door. The plywood oak.
Without being disrespectful, you know, when you go to other clubs where they've just skimped a little bit on the finishing, it's you can see a massive difference. I don't know whether it's looked at you. No, it isn't. Whoops.
Hello.
I won't go in that one. Every room has a joke kitchen.
It caused a stir in there.
I love it.
Very special guests, Sir Bobby Robson. And with them, Gary Lineker. I know he's got a very special birthday coming up. So Bobby is 70.
40.
40. After three. One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
It's me him.
Happy birthday to you.
Me him.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you very much.
I don't
have to be premature,
but
it's okay. Come on, let's go. Where's Gary? I hate being late, because I know that's a lack of self-discipline anyway. The things I criticise the players on. I always say, the players will tell you, my favourite saying to the players is, look, you're late. And if you were catching a train, the train's just got out the station and you're left on the blinking platform.
We regret to announce the 8:42 is running approximately 25 minutes late.
Oh, right, okay, Gaffer. So then we call a meeting for 12 o'clock or something, and come 5 to 12, no Bobby, come at 12, no Bobby, 5 past 12, 10 past 12. So eventually he turned up at 12:15, where someone had talked to him from the press had rung him up. So there was a reason why he was late. But as soon as he used to walk in, all the lads would go, woo-hoo!
And that train, I might tell you, is late. Very many times.
Woohoo! It's one of those ones. Train's gone. You should be all right. He didn't know what we thought it's all about, but it's to be the case.
I've just said to you, Hazel, this is my press officer. No, I won't say it's on camera.
I think that's the question everybody's wondering about.
They're fighting for their lives. We're fighting just to try and get into the Challenge League again.
About the obvious.
Okay.
Thanks, Bob.
Thanks, Bob. Thank you.
Come on then. The last set of fours were quite different, but it's a fella here called Gary Lineker. But not the same player as Alan. What number did you play, 99? Number 10. I knew it. I knew I was close. I knew I was close.
Is that it? Another easy day.
This is an easy day.
Is it always like this?
Yeah.
Complete madness.
I know.
Where'd you get the energy from?
But it makes your brain tick.
He's vastly experienced at handling the media now.
You ruined it. Not justified. You haven't done this club a favour.
No, I haven't seen the paper. I don't intend to.
Do you want to go in our office for
that? Yes, I think that might be a good idea.
He struggled to understand the press in those days. The problem for Bobby was he fell right in the firing line of a tabloid war at that time between the Daily Mirror and the Sun. And they went for Bobby big time. And I'll give you an example. One Daily Mirror reporter stood at the airport and said, I am here to fry him.
Greece have never scored a goal against England. If they do in this match, my God, Robson will be fried.
Is it hurtful to you to see some of the headlines that there's been, the plonker and go and...
Well, everybody is human, aren't they? And you try to ignore it, and you try to not let it upset you. And I think I try very hard about that.
You've got to remember, Bobby Robson was out as England manager before a ball was kicked in the World Cup in 1990. His contract needed to be renegotiated, and they decided that no matter what, his contract was finished and there wouldn't be another one. And then it came out that he'd done this deal with PSV Eindhoven to begin after the World Cup, and he was branded traitor, take him to the tower. You could not have said or written a worse thing about Bobby Robson ever, because the man is so passionate about his country, so patriotic. It's not true, and the insinuation was he was walking out on his country. Matter of fact, his country had just done him in.
The FA have agreed to release Mr. Robson from his contract as manager of the England team in order that he can join PSV Eindhoven as manager after the World Cup. There is absolutely no truth whatsoever in all the speculation,
garbage,
rubbish that we've seen in one or two publications today.
But he still did the press. He still spoke to them on a daily basis. He still gave them too much. Bobby would, you know, still does, gives everybody far more of his time than he should do. And he always gives them very good quotes. He's very honest. He speaks his mind.
When I seen him one day, he had been hammered and he just took a long walk along the hotel front on his own. You could see it was hurting him bad, big time then. I tried everything else to cheer the man up. I did daft things. Some worked and some didn't. So, but all the lads done daft things for me. You know, they come in the restaurant and have the sweets and all that, and then have the main course, and then have the starter, and go that way down the line, just to cheer him up and all that. And he had his own fighting spirit, apart from being heard from that leg.
It's quite ridiculous and outrageous and obscene what happened to me, but there it is, that's what happened. I couldn't stop it, nothing I could do about it. And Don, I remember Don, you know, when we spoke to, had to explain to players what had happened. Don said, well, you don't have to explain anything. The players understand that. They're going to carry on next year. They might get transferred during the World Cup or before the World Cup or after the World Cup. You do the same. He's very sensible about it and very intelligent. And he's very supportive of me. So he stood with me. That's why he's been a great close associate of mine. And I've loved the fella. And I mean loved him. Been a great, great guy for me, Don Howe. Play together, we finish together.
And the press decided, because it was Bobby's last World Cup, that they put a lunch on for him and make a presentation to him. And everybody said, well, he'll never turn up. I mean, it was war. He turned up, had the lunch, told everybody they were a scurrilous lot, and said, thank you very much indeed for everything. One or two of you I like, most of you I can't stand. Stood there and did it. Stood there and did it. And we bought him an ancient map of Sardinia from Middle Ages or whatever. And he treasured it to this day.
I had a good team around me. I didn't have any fools around me. Charlie Woods and Howard Wilkinson, John Lyle, and Dave Sexton was one of my scouts who were well up in the game, and their judgment was spot on.
Now that is important. Anton Deck.
We get 80 to 90 letters a day.
A day.
Don't we?
Yeah.
A day.
But the trouble is, you say yes to everything.
Well, no, he doesn't.
Not now, I don't.
He does, you don't.
Adam,
you say the no.
Says, yeah.
I do, yeah. I'm a soft touch, to be honest. Sorry. You can have my job, it's easy. I'll see the chairman tonight.
You're on, Bobby.
So shall I get a copy of the schedule of tour?
I better go and just find out what I've got to do, yes. It's absolutely amazing. It's like a hotel. Look at all the escalators. It's fantastic. Have you met us? Yeah, I'm not really. I've seen my wife. You don't know who the two are? Oh, no. I'll sign away for once I know. Come here, sit down, eh?
Yeah, we're gonna sit.
Turn on.
Yeah.
What about that?
One more.
3,000 quid, thank you.
That's been a privilege.
Sir John Hall. Hey, you're lucky, eh?
Yeah, it's gone, just caught before.
I just call myself Bobby.
Hey, thank you much.
Alan, can you just turn it down?
Alright?
I'm fine.
Good.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. Chris, you
alright?
Alright.
These are the two gentlemen who very kindly put up a lot of money for a charity, and part of the prize is to just come in and say hello to you. Deserves give, eh? I hope you get it this month as well, and any February, alright? Alright, well played.
People say it's luck. Yeah, he's lucky. You know, whatever he's doing is luck.
It's not luck, it's work, it's hard work.
As Graham Paul blows the whistle and the ball goes all the way back to Carlo Nash, who's in goal for Manchester City. Oh, and he's been charged down by Shearer, who should score! And he does! 10 seconds on the clock, and Alan Shearer... There's the final whistle at St James's Park. Newcastle have beaten Manchester City by...
It's a great victory, that massive for us. Put on, JJ, run your heart out, sir. Get some good stuff on the ball, well done.
Drop a few points, don't we, sir?
You know, I'm not like you, John. I don't have time for a haircut.
Yeah, I got a sax for my haircut.
Yeah? Shearer was tough and sturdy, wasn't he?
And he always is, isn't he?
He's always tough and sturdy. Ballas was dynamic pace. Dyer was scintillating over the ground. He has such high energy.
Are you going curly?
Who's the little lad then, Gordon?
It's my grandson.
All
so
right.
He's waiting for your autograph. Oh. We'll get
well,
it.
Well, don't wait. Give us it.
Oh. In you go.
Is it yours?
Yes.
And what's your name? Oliver. So it's to Olivier.
Yeah, Oliver.
Oliver. I'm trying to speak French. Olivier.
Ah.
Olivier is your granddaughter. Yeah, just in case you got mixed up, that's all.
You know, we talked about the quality of his coaches, how is he able to coach a team. But what's more important is, he's a gentleman, you know, he's a human being. You know, he's always, you know, explained to you in a gentle way, not in an aggressive way, you know. He's a human being. Yeah. I like him.
Are there any times when I don't like Bobby Robson? Just maybe I think when I spent maybe too much time at the club and I should have been home a bit earlier. I don't think my family have suffered. But they haven't seen enough of me and I haven't seen enough of them. And I didn't spend enough time with my three sons because the job was eating at me. And I regret that. In spite of loving the game dearly, immensely. I feel that I have been somewhat removed from my family, and I didn't give my family the time that most husbands do, I think.
How do you go? All right.
Mm. Very good.
Yeah. Nice. Fantastic.
He's unbelievable. He
never stops, does he?
No. So much energy. Uh-huh. And his enthusiasm and passion has not dimmed.
Sincere England days. No.
The England manager, Bobby Robson, has been taking time to stop and think. Reflecting on defeat was the last thing he or his players expected to be doing today.
Before that World Cup, Michael Parton, he did a Desert Island disc with me. And I chose me numbers, you know. Quite keen on Sinatra. And on that particular day, we'd lost to Portugal. And it was after training, I was on the balcony, I had a balcony, and I had my earphones on, and I was listening to Desert Island Discs.
Let's have another record, Bobby. She
may be with headlines the next day, Robson in despair. Yeah. I was actually listening to Frank Sinatra singing Swinging Down the Lane with me, or something like that, you know, having the time of my life. But that's what happened.
Things get painted in the media.
But we've got that valuable point, if you remember.
Yeah, that would be
important. It would be important.
Closes it, and Lineker says thank you very much.
And then, of course, that game, Argentina.
Did you think he handled it? Did you know he handled it?
No.
Didn't you?
No, I couldn't see. I was hanging about at the other end, as usual. But
well, I saw it clearly. And I was quite composed. Obviously, he's given a free kick for us. And then I saw the lines were running up. And I said, I'm going, hey, Don, I think he's given it.
And the goal is given.
Couldn't believe it. But you know the game I really liked? How we got out of that game, I'll never know. The way you got the two penalties.
Cameroon. They were unlucky, actually.
They were
unlucky. You would say, wouldn't you? Oh, yeah. You know, we've been unlucky a few times, but on that occasion, we sort of got away with it.
And here's Lineker! And he's brought down a penalty.
If you remember, I said to you, when you took that third penalty, the second penalty, which was the third goal, what were you thinking of? You said to me you were thinking about your brother.
Brother, correct.
I was saying, I hope he scores because my father will come out.
England lead by 3-2. two goals for Gary Lineker from the penalty spot.
Cut the semi-final. And that was in 1990. And look at him. And 1 year later, went.
Shame. There's the grandchildren.
Terrific. And they've grown up very, very fast. Mm. This is Alexandra, who wrote this fantastic poem when he... Well, I think it's fantastic, but then I'm obviously biased. When he was 9 years of age, his teacher said to him one day, to all the class, the word is change, write a poem about change. Well, I would struggle on that. He's on about the flowers and the bees and the animals. And then he says, but it's only me that has changed.
Quite deep, man. Quite profound.
I think so. I think it's very profound. And I've got two lovely daughters with one of my sons, Lucy and Olivier, and Isabel and Alexander. Here we are. I wrapped my life around this club for 2 years.
Hi. Bobby, very kind, you all the best.
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
Cheers.
Good
luck.
I'll bring you there, sir. You really went over.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Rowe.
Life is strange. I love Barcelona. Yeah.
It's a madhouse, though, isn't it?
Oh, it's a madhouse.
I was working with him in Barcelona. I found him again. And in that time was a difficult year for him.
Even before the end of the season, despite all the success, they were going to bring in Van Gaal and move you upstairs. That was
bizarre. And I didn't know, you know.
Yeah. They used you as a bridge.
That's right. But they didn't tell me. Mm. That was the disaster. If they told me, I don't think I would have gone. Mm. When I left here, I never, ever thought that I would return competitively. They didn't think I'd do so well, Gary, you see. Mm. The two previous years, Joe and Cruyff had won nothing. Finished nowhere, won nothing. I'm going there, Bobby Robson, not as good as Johan Cruyff, so he'll do even worse. And after 1 year, sorry, Bobby, I'm doing very well, you have to go.
Bueno, ha sido un año espectacular. Un año que de cuatro competiciones hemos ganado tres. Hemos estado en segundo en la otra. Pues como entrenador, sin duda, es uno de los más grandes del mundo.
Sir, Bobby. No, Louis. And of course they were embarrassed now. They didn't know what to do with me. And I actually did say to them, well, what do we do? And I said, well, get move out Louis. Oh, we can't do that, you know, for 3 years. So I said, okay, so I'll be the gentleman, I'll walk out. Yeah. And the chairman, to be fair to him, was a nice man, said, look, we'd like you to stay. I said, what else? Well, something similar. But I was the best paid scout in the world. I'm telling you, no, I was. There was no scout paid like I was in Barcelona because they paid me my trainer's salary. Yeah.
Yes, here we are in the Catalunya Square, and this is where we have also the main department store here on to the left, El Corte Inglés. But you will see.
I thought that was me.
Oh, yeah.
On the back of the bus.
On the back of the bus.
What are you doing there?
I don't know. But I like the girl on the left.
He's
been moonlighting.
Come on! You may never see this again, Andy. Give him to Harrogate. And then I came home to retire, to be honest. And I had June, July and August. And for the first time for 50 years, I wasn't going to a football match. And I tell you, I have to tell you this, I didn't like it. I said, I've got to get a job. She said, no, you haven't. Just enjoy our life. Retire. You know, take me shopping. I said, I'm not taking you shopping. That's what. And I didn't know what I was irritable. I didn't think I would. I thought I could just retire and miss it. Mm. And I couldn't.
Geordie's always got that 1% that other managers haven't got. The love of the club, the area, they've got the Geordie chip in. People say, well, it's 1%, you've got Hullier, you've got Wenger. Yeah, fine, they'll work. I think it's important for Newcastle to have that Geordie chip in, even if it's 1%. Age didn't matter. He's good enough, and he's proved right.
Do you know what he said today? He said he doesn't want to go shopping with you. He just wants to be on the training ground and talking to the press and the media.
That's right. We've never gone shopping together, have we?
We've never been shopping together.
No. Never been shopping
not
together.
Never, never, but like, no, if we do, we probably argue. So.
It would be the only time we do argue then.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'm never there to be.
No, to argue.
To be argumentative.
Mm. Has it been difficult with the amount of. With his obsession with football and his passion, his energy, and the fact that, I mean, I've spent a day with him today, he's been. Mm. You know, the man's a workaholic. Mm. Or does it keep the relationship fresh that the fact that you hardly ever see him?
Well, you know, you've got these periods where you're apart, and then when you come together again, that's a real adjustment.
Mm.
So I think that's difficult.
Did you used to watch him play?
Always, yes.
Was he any good?
I think the new boy that Bob has here at Newcastle, Jemis, is like
yeah.
Bob used to play, because he goes Jemis? Up and down, and yeah. And he's very athletic looking, and really I think
I am or he is.
Well, you were.
All right. Oh,
but he is.
Right. I get the message. Okay.
He played a number of times. England scored a few goals as well, but you didn't you miss the first
oh,
two?
Oh, just let me come
go
in
on,
here.
Carry on.
Please let me come in. We played Scotland.
Yeah.
We actually won the game 9-3, the fabulous historical game of England beating Scotland 9-3 at Wembley. And I scored the first goal that day.
In the ninth minute, Bobby Robson scored.
And I was looking very, you know, yeah. You can't see him. Thinking my wife would be very proud of me. I got home that night as we did and talked about the game. She said, I've got something to confess. I said, right. She said, you scored the first goal, didn't you? I said, of course I did, you saw it. She said, well, no, I didn't. And they'd got delayed in the traffic jam.
Gee.
And you'd missed my goal, hadn't you?
Yeah, yeah. We saw the rest of the game.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Saw Jimmy Greaves scoring, Johnny Haynes, Bobby Charlton, but like never saw her husband. Like, oh, she said, how did you do that? Then she said, I said, well, I just put it past the keeper in that 8x8.
It's not. Yeah. It's not always easy. I mean, looking back now, everyone thinks it's success, but it can't. You know, you've had lots of spells in your career, haven't you? But always come through them, it seems.
Oh yeah, and a few trials and tribulations, and a few ups and downs. I mean, I lasted. I went on a 3-year contract at Fulham and lasted 8 months, and bitter about it, and thought, well, will I ever get another chance? Mm. The right club for me came at the right time. Johnny Cobbold and the board of directors, and I finally finished on a 10-year contract. And I finally finished working there for about 14 years. One of the biggest decisions I've ever had to make in my life was that decision was to leave Ipswich and go to England.
Was that a tough decision?
Oh yeah.
Really?
I'll tell you why. Because I had a great quality of life. Nobody had a better car than me, because I had a Jaguar. Nobody earned more money than me, and I mean that. I was the best paid guy at Ipswich. The chairman would not allow any player to earn more than me. Now, that doesn't happen now. Players earn far more than managers. Still don't think that's quite right.
Mm.
But when we won, he had a bottle of champagne. And when we lost, he had two bottles of champagne.
In those days, you tell me he didn't drink. But he's improved, he's learnt a bit.
That was his civilised way of looking at defeat.
Yeah.
He was a remarkable guy. Yeah. He really was an outstanding fella.
You had a lot of fights in your life, Bobby, but no greater fight than when you fought off cancer. That must have been quite a shock.
Yes, it was.
But this particular scan here actually shows the type of defect that you're left with following this surgery.
In a way, my wife saved my life, because I came on one day, I was in Porto, and I came on one day, and as he said to me, I've arranged for the doctor to see about your sinus. I said, I haven't got a sinus problem. She said, yes, you have. You've had it for years. I said, no, I haven't. I know what I've got. I've got sinusitis. I deal with it. She said, well, you've got to go. So I went to the doctors, and he said, well, I've got to refer you to an ear, nose and throat specialist. And I came back home, and I played Merry War with her. I said, there you are. I've now got to go to a specialist. I haven't got time. I hadn't got time to go to the doctors, and now I haven't got time to go to...
Is he stubborn?
No.
So he cleaned me out, and he said, you know, I've taken a little biopsy, and I have some very grave news for you. I said, really? So I said, what's that? He said, well, you have a malignant melanoma in your nose, in your face, inside your face. And I didn't know what he meant. I'd never heard of a malignant melanoma. I nearly said to him, well, we don't need one of those. You know, I thought he was talking about the right half we played for. The right half we played for Bayern Munich. And I said, a malignant melanoma? What's that?
The cancer itself is situated just there and extending into what's known as the maxilla.
How did you react? What was your thought? Were you scared? Were you...
Well, it's scary when they say to you, well, you've got to lose all your top teeth.
Yeah.
And you're going to have an incision right through the middle of your face.
Yeah.
So it's very scary. Mm. I mean, imagine if someone was...
It was inside my
you.
Face, you see. It wasn't on the top. So they had to cut me through here and through my lip. They severed my lip. They took my teeth out, all my teeth out, and they went through the roof of my mouth.
Yeah.
This would be the roof of somebody's mouth who's undergone a maxillectomy. And that's a technical operation to carry out. It's a major operation, but patients have to be able to return and regain their normal life. And there are two essential ways, depending on the type of operation and the extent. You can either construct something like this, which is what we call an obturator, which can work very well for some patients, so that it looks like an ordinary upper denture. And I do remember the very first time he was asked to fit the obturator and take it out himself. He didn't think he could actually do it, and he actually felt he would never be able to do it. And I think that was the lowest point of his treatment.
I had to practice to get it in, you know, and get it out. It has to be very tight fitting. And I had some problems, and I remember Elsie saying to me, look, go in the bathroom and close the door and practice. And I happened to get it out, you know, with a bit of movement and so forth, trial and error. And then I couldn't get it back in again. And I cried. I sat on the edge of the bed and I cried. And I couldn't get this obturator back into my face to reshape my face, because it, you know, it keeps me perfect, you see. And if, without it, my face collapses. I mean, it's a terrible thing to talk about, but that's the way it is. And without it, I can't live. And you know, Gary, since that, and it became public later on, and I used it as a...
To raise funds, really, for
the
cancer.
He asked me, would I be prepared to make it public? And it was Cancer Awareness Week.
Awareness, yeah.
And I said, okay.
Whereas across the country, some hospitals had 30 patients might have come in, we had hundreds of patients, and they were given an opportunity to write at the bottom of their medical questionnaire why they were coming, and the vast majority of them wrote Bobby Robson.
And they found 8 people with cancer in their mouth, and those 8
they
people
were unaware of it
out of 800. So, you know, in a way, it worked. Mm. So
it's a positive response.
Did it change your view on life in any way, on thing? I mean, it's obviously not stopped you working, that's for sure.
No, it hasn't stopped me working.
He wanted to get back to work, and that's been great therapy.
Did you have to fight him on that, or did you think that was a good thing?
Well, you can't fight Bob on things.
No. I'm not sure there is anything beyond football for him. He loves the game, and he's good at what he does. And as far as he's concerned, one of the things he's always told me, every Monday morning, I can't wait to get to work. Well, how many of us can truthfully say that every Monday morning?
And you're fine now, and you're healthy, and
I'm
working
terrific.
Hard.
This obturator makes me talk, makes me drink, makes me eat, and I'm fine.
It's certainly not stopped you talking.
No. that's or eating.
Elsie, I've already asked. I've asked Bobby, how long do you think he'll... Do you think he'll ever walk away from...
Oh, you can't say that. You can't talk in those terms. Mm. It's up to him. Mm. When he wants to, he'll do it, I'm sure.
70th birthday. Is there anything that you haven't got that you'd really like?
Yeah, promise of another 30 years of life, I suppose.
Could you guarantee me that?
Life's good. We enjoy our life, don't we?
Your enthusiasm, your passion, your energy has always amazed me, even more now we spent the whole day together, Bobby. I think, without a shadow of a doubt, you'll be the first top-flight manager of 100 years old. And here's to the next 30 years.
Oh, Gary.
Here's to the next 30 years. Cheers.
So, Bobby, on behalf of all the lads and everybody here today, all the very best. I think we better do the necessary.
No.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Oh, thank you very much.
Happy birthday.
Thank you very much. It's very nice of you.
Happy birthday to you.
It's a tough world out there. And if you're not a tough guy, you won't survive. Not to get to where you want to be in your sphere.